Welcome back, long time no see. This is the second part of a four-part series where I rank all the Danganronpa characters on a scale of 1 to 10. I feel like it's best for you to watch part 1 before watching this one. It talks about the characters in Trigger Happy Havoc, as well as states the rules of how I'll rank these characters. This video will be talking about the characters in Goodbye Despair. Now that that has been said, let's move on to the rankings. Goodbye Despair is the second game in the Danganronpa franchise, and it distinguishes itself with a much more humorous tone and a bright pastel color scheme. In a way, it kinda reminds me of Persona 4, with both having lighter tones and having yellow be the game's main color. When first finishing the Danganronpa series, I considered Goodbye Despair to be my favorite of the mainline games because it had some of my favorite characters in the series. That being said, it also had some of my least favorite characters in the entire series, so this game is kinda like a double-edged sword in that sense. I feel like ranking these characters will be a lot more interesting this time around because there are a lot more extremes in this sense. Whether those extremes are good or bad depends on the character.
This is what's expected. I guess that's how I should think about it. My name is Hajime Hinata.
Right off the bat, I consider Hajime to be a step up from Makoto. I found his noticeable pessimism contrasting with the game's tone to be quite interesting, and having his talent be unknown for most of the game makes players more invested in the protagonist this time around. I see Hajime as a subversion to Makoto, specifically Makoto's status as an average student among a group of prodigies. Hajime's reserved course status takes Makoto's feelings of inferiority and cranks it up to 11. You think your only reason for being in Hope's Peak was through mere chance sounds rough? Well, imagine not even being a member of Hope's Peak in the first place. Instead, the only reason why you're here is because you're paying for a reserve course full of ordinary students like you that only exist because Hope's Peak is not doing well economically. I also believe that Hajime is a character that serves more into Goodbye Despair's ongoing themes of comparison and prejudice. I could make an entire video on that someday. And how he's not only compared and judged by the actions of his ultimate classmates, but also by the actions of Isoru Kamakura. I just really like Hajime as a protagonist, especially compared to Makoto. 8 out of 10. Similar to Monokuma, I don't have much to say about Monami, but what I do have to say is that I liked her a lot. A lot of people expected her to be evil when first playing Goodbye Despair, but I actually believe she was good all along. What's ironic is that one of the reasons I believed her was due to her constant talk about Hope and, considering another character in this game, that's not that good of a reason to believe in the goodness of someone. I do think the writers did a pretty good job on making the viewers guess her intentions because there were multiple times where even I questioned her true morality. Plus, Monami's just super cute. She's one of the cutest characters in the entire series. 8 out of 10.
Yo! The name's Akane Owari. Nice to meet ya.
Just like Monami and Hajime, Akane is quite similar to another character that appears in the first game, Yasuhiro. Both are dumb, comic relief characters who, despite not playing a major role in the trials and being mostly hated by the community, happen to be survivors. Also like Yasuhiro, I like Akane. I found her constant craving for food and thick-headedness to be very charming, and I really like how sharp her teeth are. It makes her look like a werewolf. I also noticed that, despite having similar roles, Akane is a bit more story-based, while Yasuhiro is more comedy-based. However, if I were to pick the better of the two, I would have to pick Yasuhiro. There are multiple reasons for this. The first has to do with the game they are in. As a more serious game, Trigger Happy Havoc contains less comedic characters, and as such, Yasuhiro stands out more as comic relief, especially since his style of comedy widely differs from the other characters. Goodbye Despair, on the other hand, contains a lot more comedic characters, a lot of them being funnier than Akane, so Akane doesn't really stand out as much. Kazuichi and Sonya, two very comedic characters, are both survivors, so there isn't much of a reason for Akane to be one when there are more than enough laughs to go around. Another reason why I feel like Akane is worse than Yasuhiro is that she tries to become less comedic in order to give her a more meaningful role in the story. Having a serious character also serve as comedic relief can work, such as with Toko, but in Akane's case, it only hurts her. Her character arc felt very underdeveloped, and since there were so many other characters with similar arcs, she doesn't stand out, especially since hers is very weak. So not only is Akane less funny than Yasuhiro and the rest of the Goodbye Despair cast, what character depth she has over Yasuhiro is very weak in comparison to other characters. That being said, I still like Akane, just not as much as Yasuhiro. 6.5 out of 10.
My name is Byakuya Togami.
Okay, hear me out. The Ultimate Imposter has to be one of the most cleverly written and well thought out characters in the entire series. I am still in awe with how genius the writers are when creating this character. It all comes down to this one piece of dialogue in Chapter 5, where Hajime and Chiaki find out Byakuya's true identity.
Perhaps.
So cool!
The imposter's Byakuya is quite different from our Byakuya, not just in appearance, but in personality as well. And the true genius of this character is that he is able to trick the audience not only despite these differences, but also because of them. Looking back in hindsight, Tsugami's obesity may seem like a major giveaway, but thinking about it using Occam's razor, it makes total sense. People naturally change over time, and being in such a traumatic event like the Killing Game, it would make perfect sense if a character were to develop an unhealthy habit such as stress eating. In fact, it would be a lot weirder if Byakuya looked the exact same all these years later. The same thing also applies to his change in personality. In Trigger Happy Havoc, Byakuya goes through a lot in the Killing Game, and a lot of people expected him to have a change of heart at the end of the game. So when Tsugami exhibits a softer side and a helicopter parent behavior, people automatically assume it's due to the fact that he's been through a Killing Game before and not because he's a different person. The genius of the imposter is that he pretends to be something people expected the person rather than the person himself. I also enjoyed the reason why the imposter disguises his true identity is because he doesn't have one. So when he does something out of character, no one notices because everything about the imposter is unnoticeable. I like to think that the reason why he wants to be overweight is because he actually wants to stand out. But even that wasn't enough to make him noticeable. The only thing that keeps the imposter from a 10 out of 10 is something that happens in the D3 anime. Now, for the most part, the imposter is handled surprisingly well in the anime. We got to see more of his character, and I really liked his relationship with Mitarai. He's probably the only pre-existing character that benefits from being in the anime instead of the opposite. The one thing that keeps him from a perfect score is that the anime showed his true face, and the method that he was able to do it. This is really bad, since in Tsugami's Island mode, it is stated that not even the imposter himself knows his true identity. You'd think that someone who's been struggling to find out who he is for his entire life wouldn't be able to suddenly do it so easily. Plus, it's never a good idea to reveal the faces of super secret imposters like Tsugami. The entire point is that you don't know what he looks like, and revealing his true form is like telling the secret to a magic trick. It just ruins the fun. If you need to show his true self in a backstory or something, just make him a fat gray blob. It wouldn't look weird since there are already pink and blue people in the anime who obviously don't actually look like that in real life, and it would be a nice clever nod to the gray blackens in the games. That's really the only flaw I could find, and the fact that the D3 anime doesn't mess up the imposter for the most part, and even improved on him in some ways, really goes to show how amazing this character is. 9 out of 10.
I'm Chiaki Nanami, the ultimate gamer. Video games are my hobby, and I'm a fan of all genres. Nice to meet you.
Initially, Chiaki has been well received by pretty much everyone in the fandom, but as time went on, people started to become more critical of her. As for me, I really like Chiaki. In fact, out of all the female sidekicks throughout the series, she's my favorite. She's just really cute and always brings a smile to my face. I also like how, since Nagito was supposed to be the faux sidekick, Chiaki just kinda stayed in the background, rewarding players for liking her by giving her a bigger role. The main criticism I see pointed at Chiaki is that she's flawless, and unlike Sakura, she is more important of a character, meaning her flawlessness is more shoved in your face. I do not mind Chiaki's flawlessness because I see it as the point of her character. Chiaki is an AI programmed to reform the remnants of despair, so if she had any flaws, reformation would be more difficult as there could be a chance the remnants dislike her. Now, you might say that because Chiaki is a human in the anime, my argument is moot. However, her being a human was a very late decision in the production of the anime, meaning that when writing Goodbye Despair, Chiaki was not written to be a human in mind. Even if that weren't the case, her being flawless is also a good sense of foreshadowing that something is up with her. In short, I love Chiaki. 8 out of 10.
Name's Fuyuhiko Kuzuryu. Just so we're clear, I don't plan to act friendly and shit with you guys.
Like the ultimate imposter, Fuyuhiko is a character that I am in awe with how the writers handled him. In the first chapter of Goodbye Despair, our rival, Nagito, pretends to be the game's deuterogonist. Because it would be very sketchy for a Danganronpa game to lack a rival character, Fuyuhiko was created to serve as a red herring rival while Nagito was still in his facade. I feel like Fuyuhiko did a pretty good job as a red herring. He did many things similar to Byakuya, such as abandon the team and do his own thing, but has a much different personality while being equally unlikable in a I-wanna-beat-this-rival kind of way. However, after Nagito's reveal, the writers had a dilemma. Now that Nagito is the rival, Fuyuhiko doesn't serve a purpose anymore. The writers could have easily just killed Fuyuhiko off in the second case, but they didn't. Instead, they decided to give him a much-needed reformation, the first of many in this series. In fact, Fuyuhiko's reformation was so well-made, a multitude of characters from this game onward tried to replicate it, usually failing to do so in the process. Not only does Fuyuhiko serve as a clever red herring to the real rival and get salvaged, I love his personality post-reform. He's kinda chill, but also serious and angry. It's pretty hard to describe, but I love it. Fuyuhiko is great in every way. His design, personality, how he's handled in the story, everything was just done wonderfully. I cannot find a single thing wrong with this character. And you know what that means? He gets a 10 out of 10.
You may call me Gundam Tanaka. Remember it well, for it is the name that will one day rule this world.
When first playing Goodbye Despair, Gundam was actually my favorite character in the game. However, in recent times, his shtick has slightly worn off for me. This is not to say that I dislike Gundam, I still think he's a very funny character. I love the weird mix of his love for animals and, Satanism D&D? I don't know how to describe it. I feel like Gundam's name is the perfect representation of the absolute absurdity of his character. If you didn't know, Gundam is not a real Japanese name. Gundam is the name of a popular mecha anime, with an H added for hamster puns. In fact, all four of his hamsters are named after manga publishing magazines. In contrast, Tanaka is one of the most common and ordinary Japanese surnames out there. It's like naming your kid Voltron Smith, it's great! I also feel like making Gundam have a soft side enhances his character. 8 out of 10.
Hyoko Sayonji!
Okay, this is gonna be the first character on the Goodbye Despair list that I actually dislike. The main reason why I dislike her isn't because she's mean. There are many characters that I like who are much meaner than her. No, the reason why I dislike Hyoko is that, despite openly trashing on everyone else, if someone even dares to do the same thing as her, she's suddenly a helpless victim who's under attack. There's just something really obnoxious about this type of attitude for me. I feel like if a character is going to be an absolute piece of garbage, they should at least have a spine as well. One other thing I don't really like about Hyoko is that there are times, especially in Case 3, where they try to paint her in a more sympathetic light and it just really doesn't work for me. I just feel like she doesn't earn it. Maybe if she felt more regretful to her actions on others, it could work, but as it is, it just rang hollow, especially since she plays a crying child facade on the regular when she wants to avoid consequences for her actions. That being said, there are a couple things that I genuinely like about Hyoko. For one, there were multiple scenes where I found her to be quite funny, and I find her gimmick of little girl is actually a smug jerk to be pretty creative, especially in the way that they handled it. Even with her occasional humorous moments, she's pretty obnoxious for the most part. 2.5 out of 10.
Buki, Mio, Da! Put it together and what do you get? Ibuki Miyota!
I like Ibuki. She's funny and charming and that's about it. Not every character has to be super complex and well-written to be a favorite of mine. In fact, despite gushing about how well-written Celeste is and giving her a 9 out of 10, I still like Leon, a character that admittedly doesn't have much going for him, more than her. Remember, this list is based off of both my subjective opinion as well as how well-written I think a character is. So yeah, Ibuki's great. 8 out of 10.
Name's Kazuichi Soda. I'm the ultimate mechanic. Nice to meet ya!
Kazuichi Soda is one of my favorite characters in Goodbye Despair. Now, you might be thinking that he's just like all the other comedic characters, but no. Those characters may be funny, but Kazuichi isn't just funny. He's really funny. He's on a whole different level of comedy than any of the characters in the series. I just find it really difficult to explain why I find something funny. I've heard people say that it's easier to explain why they dislike something over why they like something, but for me, it's relatively easy to explain why I like certain things in detail. In fact, it can be rather fun. However, I really can't find a reason as to why I think something's funny other than it just made me laugh, and trying to explain any further than that just ruins the humor for me. So yeah, Kazuichi funny. 9 out of 10.
Let's see. I'm Mahiru Koizumi. I'll be counting on you from now on.
I did not expect a character like this to have such a split opinion in the fandom, but since she does, I would like to warn you guys that this opinion might be pretty controversial. If I were to describe how I feel about Mahiru, I would say that she is the opposite of Celeste. While I don't particularly have Celeste as one of my favorites, I can say that, on an objective level, she is one of the best written characters of Trigger Happy Havoc. Mahiru, on the other hand, while I don't hate her per se, I see her as one of the worst characters on a more objective level. While she only has two things I dislike about her, that being her constant defense of Hyoko and her casual misandry, the fact that she is a completely forgettable character otherwise makes her such a bad character. Honestly, those traits would have been perfectly forgivable if she had some traits that I liked about her as well, but there is nothing I can say good about Mahiru, so her traits just become a net negative. Now, I've been pondering whether a character like Hyoko, someone I hate more, but find things I like about her, is worse than a character like Mahiru, someone I hate less, but lacks anything good about her. I could say that Hyoko is better because she's more memorable and has likable traits. I could also say that Mahiru is better because at least I could ignore her. Regardless of who is worse, I see Mahiru as a poorly written character, and for the sake of fairness, I will give her the same ranking as Hyoko. 2.5 out of 10.
My name is Mikan Sumiki. From the bottom of my heart, I hope we can get along.
Okay, here's another really divisive character, and like Mahiru, I don't have exactly the nicest things to say about her. Throughout the majority of her time in Goodbye Despair, I found her very annoying. Whether it be her constant apologizing, accidental slips, or her English voice acting, she just bothered me. Maybe it's because she reminded me of Fluttershy too much? I don't know. However, once she was revealed to be the Case 3 killer and her personality changed, I started to actually like her. I feel like Mikan is the type of character you grow to like more as time passes. After looking at her free time events, not only do I understand why she apologizes so much, but I also like her questionable behavior, and I feel like it works well with her shy personality. Also, I find it funny that, despite that Hyoko and Mikan are constantly at odds, the times I see Hyoko bully Mikan are the best and funniest moments for both characters. 6 out of 10.
I'm Nagito Komaeda. Nice to meet you.
You probably know about my opinion of this guy in my twist villain video, but I feel like I need to elaborate a bit more on what I meant, since there were some parts that were pretty unclear. If you didn't watch that video, I said I really dislike Nagito and that he's one of my least favorite characters in the series. However, before I get into why I dislike Nagito, I want to give him a little slack and list things I like about him because, while I do hate this character, there are some things that he has going for him. Despite disliking Nagito more than Byakuya, I can say for certain that Nagito is better written than him. This is actually something I mentioned in my twist villain video, and that is that the twist that he is the rival was done masterfully. I've explained why his twist is done well in that video, so I don't feel like I need to elaborate here. I also like how Nagito's behavior actually reflects what hope and despair actually are. Because these words are tossed around so much in the series, you kind of forget what they mean. In essence, hope is the drive to do something or the desire for something to happen, while despair is the absence of hope, aka the feeling of giving up. With these definitions in mind, if you were trapped on an island and the only way to escape is through murder, killing each other would not be an example of falling into despair. Quite the opposite. If the students really fell into despair, they would just shrug things off and accept they will live on the island forever. The act of killing someone shows that they want things to change, which would be an act of hope. That's why Nagito wants to start the killing game so much. In a twisted way, each of the killings reignites a sense of hope into the classroom. Only would killing for the sake of killing be an act of despair, which Nagito condemns in Chapter 3. Something else I mentioned in this video is that I like the little parallels between Nagito and Makoto. Now that I mentioned the things I actually like about this character, let's talk about the negatives. I mentioned in the Twist Villains video that his personality feels like that of a cliche creepypasta OC. I feel like, back in 2012, his character would have had a much better impression on me, but now, this type of character has been done to death and been mocked for unrelenting edginess. I just can't find a character like this interesting anymore. I also mentioned that I find a lot of his actions to be self-contradictory. Now, this point was poorly worded and a lot of people thought I was talking about the incident in Chapter 4, and that is not the case. Him turning on the cast made perfect sense. What I am talking about was something in the free time events on 2.5 anime, where at one point, Nagito loves Talon in the Ultimates, but is also supposed to secretly hate Talon in the Ultimates besides Hajime? Another example of something I found contradictory is that he thinks he is talentless, but acknowledges his supernatural powers and even humble brags about them. These contradictions feel like they were only here so that the writers could further compare him to Makoto. See? He's talentless and loves the Ultimates, just like Makoto, except not really? I was looking for a word for how Nagito feels to me, and I think I finally found it. Pretentious. The writing for Nagito just feels very pretentious for me. I understand what they are trying to do, but at times, I feel like the writing for Nagito thinks it's more clever than it actually is. That being said, there are some good things about Nagito, but I still don't like him. 4 out of 10. Also, I just want to say one more thing, and that's how Mikan and Nagito are actually very similar in many ways. Pretty interesting to think about, huh?
I am the ultimate team manager, Nekomaru Nidai!
Finally, a non-controversial Danganronpa character! One more hot take and it would've been sent to the gallows for sure! Honestly, I don't have a strong opinion on this guy, but I do have one particular thing to say. Isn't Danganronpa an M-rated game? You know, for mature audiences? 3 out of 10.
My name is Peko Pekoyama. It is nice to meet you too.
She's another character that I don't really have an opinion on. If I had to say something about her, it's that she's kind of an anti-Mahiru, which is funny since Peko killed Mahiru. You know how I said that Mahiru is just a bland character overall except for a few bad traits? Well, Peko is just a bland character overall save for a couple good things about her. She did help kickstart Fuyuhiko's reformation, and her punishment was one of the best in the series. However, I feel like Danganmandy said it best when she stated that the only reason Peko's even noticed at all is in relation to Fuyuhiko. 5 out of 10.
My name is Sonya Nevermind.
I hate Sonya. Now before you say anything, Sonya is a good character. There's nothing wrong with her. I just have this irrational hatred for her that's lasted ever since I saw her, which I now call the Sonya effect. The Sonya effect goes like this. I see a suspicious character, which I will call the Sonya, and immediately think she's either evil or a killer. This goes on throughout the entire game, where I accuse the Sonya of being the murderer in every single trial. However, not only does it turn out that, in this case, the Sonya isn't a murderer or evil, but also that she's one of the survivors of the game, which makes me hate her even more. There's also another Sonya in this video, but that's a story for another segment. In all seriousness, Sonya is pretty good. I love how politically messed up her kingdom is, and how a girl like her obsesses over the occult and military weapons. I also find it really funny how she tries to fit in with the others and completely fails. Initially, I thought her romance with Gundam would be squicky, but they're actually perfect for each other. 7 out of 10.
My name is Teru Teru Hanamura. On the streets, I'm known as the ultimate cook. But could you guys call me the ultimate chef instead? It has more of a big city flavor to it, you know?
I feel like it's rather fitting that we end Goodbye Despair off with this character because, no matter how many controversial and unpopular opinions I have, it seems like everyone can agree that Teru Teru is unlikable to at least some degree. Now, I could talk about his creepy behavior or the fact that it could be argued that he's somewhat of an offensive caricature, but I want to talk about something different. At the end of Chapter 1, the writers tried to make Teru Teru more sympathetic by establishing his backstory with his mother, but to me, it just raises more questions than answers. Usually the free time events explain why certain characters are the way that they are, such as with Kazuichi, Mahiru, and Hyoko. But for Teru Teru, one of the main gimmicks of him is just left unanswered. Is it weird to call a character like Teru Teru somewhat missed potential? Not like anyone really cares about Teru Teru, and there were some things answered about him. That being said, there's a reason why this guy is one of the most hated characters in the game. 2 out of 10. Ranking the characters in Goodbye Despair is much different than ranking the characters in Trigger Happy Havoc. While nearly all of the Trigger Happy Havoc characters were around a 7 out of 10, the rankings for the Goodbye Despair characters were either really high or really low. I guess Goodbye Despair is the glass cannon of the series in that respect. Thank you for watching.